This is lesson 2.1. We're going to be talking about linear equations in this lesson, basically an introduction of what linear equations are and how to write them in standard form. So in this lesson, we'll be looking at linear versus nonlinear equations and recognizing them. We'll be writing equations in standard form. We'll also be looking at finding x and y intercepts and graphing them in that way. And we'll be looking at an application problem. Our application problem will be dealing with the speed of sound. Did you know that sound travels at different speeds through different types of objects or medians? When we're writing linear equations, we now have two variables. Just as in the last lesson we talked about domain and range, we're talking about our independent and our dependent variables. So an independent variable is one where there's a little more flexibility to it, where you decide how long something's going to run or how many objects you're going to put into the machine, whatever that may be. The dependent variable is influenced or controlled by the independent variable. So for example, if I only put 50 cents into the vending machine, that's my input, more my independent variable, my money, how much money I put into the machine. My dependent variable is, well, what is allowed to come out of the machine? Well, if I only put 50 cents in, I'm not going to be able to get maybe a big bag of Doritos because maybe they cost $1.25. So I haven't put in the right kind of input to get the desired output. So just as another example, here's a sort of the classic distance equals rate times time. Here we have a function, d of t, so distance is the function, and the variable, the input, is time. Then we have our rate that it's traveling at, and we have the time that passes as your input variable. So in this situation, the independent variable is going to be the time. And the reasoning for that is that you decide how long you're going to let it travel before you measure how far it's gone. So the more time that goes by, the further that sound has traveled. So in this situation, time is your independent variable. Your dependent variable is going to be the distance, which in this case is being measured in feet. It's dependent because it depends upon how long the sound travels. So if you let the sound travel for 10 seconds before measuring it, then it's going to go so far. If you only let it travel for 5 seconds before you measure how far it's gone, then it's traveled less in this particular example. A linear equation is when you graph it, it's a straight line. It's pretty straightforward. Now, there are some ways to know visually in an equation whether you have a linear equation or not. So there are two main things that we look for. First thing we want to look for is we look at the variables and we look to make sure that the exponents on those variables are 1. If there's anything other than 1, that means both positive, negatives, and fractions. So we're looking for an exponent of 1 for a linear equation. We also don't want to have variables in the denominator. That produces other types of graphs that you'll learn about in pre-calculus or other college-level math courses. So we have 4 examples here. And we can quickly apply these rules to see whether we have linear or nonlinear equations. So if you look at the first one, we can see that our exponents on our variables are 1, since we don't see an exponent. And there aren't any variables in the denominator, so we know that this is a linear equation. The second one to the right, if you look, is nonlinear. It's nonlinear because we have a variable whose exponent is something other than 1. So this would be nonlinear. The third example, 4x equals 1 is linear, even though there is no y variable. Notice that's not a requirement in the definition up above. If we would graph this, we would end up getting a vertical line. The variable's exponent is 1. There are no variables in the denominator of a fraction, so that is a linear equation. Finally, the last example is nonlinear because we have variables in the denominator of a fraction. It would graph something else. A linear function is simply a function that makes a straight line. And so, for example, we would have f of x equals mx plus b would be typically the form that it would be written in. You're used to seeing it as y equals mx plus b. Now, there is one linear equation that is not a linear function, and that would be a vertical line, something of the form x equals 5 or x equals a number. And so that is not a function because it fails the vertical line test. A constant function is basically a horizontal line. That's f of x equals a number. And so here are a few examples on this graph. This one right here would be f of x equals 4. The one down at the bottom could be g of x equals negative 4. And the darker one at the top could be h of x equals 8. So those are constant functions. The slope is 0, and so you end up with a horizontal line. The zero function isn't super exciting. It's f of x equals 0. And that would be the horizontal line that goes over the x-axis. The other thing that we need to look at is determining whether an equation is in standard form or not. If you remember from Algebra 1, the purpose of standard form is that we follow a set of rules to write our equation, and then we'll be able to see that our equations are identical. So the rules for standard form as follows. The first one is that x and y need to be on the same side of the equation. It needs to be written in the form ax plus by equals c. Now it's okay if the x and the y term are switched around, but the important part is that x and y are on the same side and the constant is on the other side. The next requirement is that both the coefficients and the constants are not allowed to be fractions or decimals. And so we would need to eliminate those fractions or decimals in order to put it in standard form. The next requirement is that the coefficient of x, which is the a, has to be positive or greater than or equal to 0. The next requirement isn't necessarily important to us. I'm not going to try to trick you or test you in this way, but one of the requirements for standard form is that you have to have at least the x variable or the y variable. They both can't not be there. So you can't have a linear equation in standard form that says 7 equals 7. This last one is new for Algebra 2. So another requirement of something being in standard form is that the greatest common factor between coefficients and the constant is 1. And so we'll look at these examples below in order to see these different options. So if we look at the top left, we'll just basically look above and use that as a checklist. Are x and y on the same side? Yes. Are there any fractions or decimals in this problem? No. Is the coefficient of x positive? Yes. And then is the GCF between the 2, the 4, and the 5 1? Yes. So this linear equation is in standard form. So let's look at the second one. Are x and y on the same side of the equation? Yes. Are the coefficients and the constants fractions or decimals? No. So that's good. We don't want them to be fractions or decimals. Is the coefficient of x positive? No, it's not. So that violates rule letter B up above, and so this would be not in standard form. Now we could do things to this to put it in standard form, and we'll look at that in the examples later. The next one. Are x and y on the same side? Yes. Are the coefficients and constants fractions or decimals? And in this case, we have an issue. We have the y coefficient is a fraction or a decimal, in this case 1/2. So that means that this is not in standard form. So the next one says 3x equals 15. So we'll do our checklist. Are x and y on the same side? Well, there isn't a y, so we're not really worried about that. So is the variable on one side and is the constant on the other side? Yes, it is. The next requirement is, are there any fractions or decimals? And there aren't any, so option A is good to go. Is the coefficient of A positive? It is, so there's no violation there. Now the last one is where we run into an issue. Is the GCF between the coefficients and the constants 1? And in this case, the answer is no. The greatest common factor between 3 and 15 is 3. So that means that this is not in standard form. However, it would be very easy to put it in standard form by dividing both sides by 3. The next one, are x and y on the same side? Well, just like the last problem, there isn't an x variable, so we're not really worried about it. But the constant is on the right side, the variable is on the left side, so we're good to go. We don't have any fractions or decimals. The coefficient of x doesn't matter here because there is no x term. And then the last one is the GCF. And the GCF between 1 and 18 is 1. So yes, this is in standard form. For our last one, let's see what we get. Are x and y on the same side? Yes, they are. Are there any fractions or decimals? No. 2, 6, 18. Is the coefficient of x positive? Yes, it is. Please note, as with this example and the first example, we do not care if the y term is negative. We only care whether the x term is positive or negative. And then our last one that we really need to check is the GCF between the A, the B, and the C 1. And in this case, the answer is no. We have a GCF of 2. So this is not in standard form. The intercepts are where the graph crosses the x and y intercept. So the y intercept is where it crosses the y axis. The x intercept is where it crosses the x axis. So in this graph here, you can see that the x intercept would be right here and the y intercept would be right there. And you'll notice that in their example with the ordered pairs, that one of the coordinates is going to be 0, which makes sense because if you plot a point on the axis, then one of those ordered pairs has to be 0 because you haven't either traveled in the vertical or horizontal direction, depending on which point you're looking at. So how do I find the x and y intercepts? So if I want to find the y intercept, then remember that you're trying to find the y coordinate, which means that the x has to be 0. That's my memory hint. So you're finding the y, which means that you're going to substitute in 0 for the x in the equation, and you're going to solve for the y variable. If you're trying to find the x-intercept, then you're trying to find the x-coordinate, which means that the 0 is going to go into the y variable, and you're going to solve for x. So here's an example where we're going to find the x and the y-intercept. So if we find the y-intercept first, that means I'm trying to find the y variable when x equals 0. So I'm going to substitute in 0 for x. The nice thing about intercepts is the math is very easy since you're working with 0. So 5 times 0 is 0. So I'm going to end up with negative 3y equals 15. We'll divide both sides by negative 3, and we get y equals negative 5. So the ordered pair for the y-intercept, when we substitute in 0 for x, we ended up getting negative 5 for the y. And so that's the point where 5x minus 3y equals 15 crosses the y-axis. To find the x-intercept, you're trying to find the x variable, and that means that the y is going to get the 0. So 3 times 0 is 0. And then 5x minus 0 would just be 5x. So we get 5x equals 15. We'll divide both sides by 5. And you get x equals 3. So as an ordered pair, the x coordinate was 3 when the y coordinate is 0. And so these would represent my x and y intercepts. And then all you need to do is plot those two points on a number line. And then you would draw a line between them. So I'm going to plot these two points. Make sure that your x-intercept is on the x-axis and your y-intercept is on the y-axis. And that will help you to make sure that you plot those points correctly, which is a common mistake that students make. So we've got 3 on the x, so there's my x-intercept. And then we have negative 5 on the y-axis, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so right here. And then you just take your ruler, and you draw a line between them. And so then that is the graph of that linear equation. Intercepts are actually pretty nice to graph with, as long as the x and y coordinates that you get for your intercepts are nice whole ordered pairs. If you end up getting fractions or decimals, then this isn't really the best method to use. This problem is yours, so go ahead and pause the video and try it for yourself, and then unpause the video to hear the explanation. So here are your x and y intercept. In order to find the y intercept, I first substituted in 0 into the x spot because I'm trying to find the y value for the y intercept. And then when I simplified and solved for y, I ended up getting y equals 4. And so you get a y-intercept at 0, 4. For the x-intercept, you're trying to find the x value. So you can see that I put the 0 in the y spot. And when I solved for x, I got x equals negative 6. And so you get negative 6, 0 for the x-intercept. Your next step was then to graph those 2 points. Again, make sure that the y-intercept ends up on the y-axis and the x-intercept ends up on the x-axis. And then you'll take your ruler and draw a line. These problems are yours to try. So pause the video, determine whether they're not linear or nonlinear, and write an explanation for the nonlinear examples. Then go ahead and resume the video to hear an explanation. So here are the answers to these 3 problems. The first one is nonlinear. Remember that when we're looking to decide whether something is linear or nonlinear, we're looking at the exponents on the variables, and then we're also looking to see if there's variables in the denominators. So in S2, we have a variable that has an exponent that's not 1. So that makes it nonlinear. And you can see my explanation says that, that a variable has an exponent other than 1. Make sure that you do say other than 1 and not more than or less than 1, because negative exponents or fractional exponents or exponents that are higher than 1, those are all nonlinear. So we're looking for a 1 or not 1. S3 is linear. My variable's exponents are 1. And there's no indication that my variables are in the denominator of a fraction. The third one was just sort of a test. We'll learn more about these types of equations later on in the year. But it is nonlinear. It's a square root equation. And you'll learn later on that a square root has a power of 1/2 when you convert it into a power from a root. And so this is nonlinear. These 2 are also yours, so go ahead and pause the video, try them, and then resume the video to hear the explanation. So S5 was also sort of a challenge problem. It's nonlinear, because if you would solve it for y, or attempt to solve it for x, you would end up with a variable down in the denominator, and so this doesn't produce a linear function. We will also learn about these types of graphs and learn how to graph them later in the year. For S6, this is a linear equation. It happens to be a vertical line, so it's not a function. This question asks us to write the equation in standard form and then to identify the A, the B, and the C. Remember, for standard form, we want X and Y to be on the same side. We want X's coefficient to be positive. We need the GCF between the terms and the constants to be 1, and we don't want any fractions or decimals. So when I look at this, I see that x and y are not on the same side. Now, there are several different ways to solve this, but since x already has a positive coefficient, I don't really want to move that. So instead of subtracting 10x from both sides, I'm going to add the 25 on both sides. And then I'm going to subtract the 5y. And then I don't have to worry about manipulating the signs on the 10. So I go ahead and subtract 5y from both sides. And I get 25 equals 10x minus 5y. And if you notice, this satisfies most of our conditions of standard form. So we have x and y on the same side. There are no fractions or decimals. And the coefficient of x, which is 10 at this point, is positive. Now the rule that hasn't been satisfied yet, which is the new one for this year, is that the coefficients and the constants need to have a GCF of a 1, which at this point, they don't. They have a GCF of 5. So I need to divide all terms on both sides by 5 to give me 5 equals 2x minus y, and now this is in standard form. So the a ends up being the coefficient of x, which is 2. The b is the coefficient of y, so that's a negative 1. Remember, it's a negative 1 because there's that minus sign in front of the y, and then there's a 1 in front of the y since there isn't any other coefficient listed. And then c is the constant, and so that gives me a 5. These two problems are yours, so go ahead and pause the video. Try to write these equations in standard form, identifying the a, b, and c, and then resume the video to hear the explanations. So here are our two answers. For S7, we have y equals 40. It's in standard form. X and y are on the same side of the equation. In this case, there is no x, so y is on one side, constant is on the other side. There are no fractions or decimals, and that's what I did in the first step. I had to get rid of that 0.25. Since that's a quarter, I knew that if I multiplied it by 4, then that would eliminate the decimal. The GCF between the coefficients and the constant are 1, and we don't have to worry about the coefficient of x since there is no x term. So the a value is 0, the b value is 1, and the c value is 40. For the other one, you may have ended up doing this in one or two steps depending on how observant you were. I noticed that x and y were already on the same side, but I had fractions. I also had a negative x coefficient. So I decided to kill two birds with one stone and get rid of the fractions and that negative on the x at the same time. So by multiplying both sides by negative 2, I was allowed to get rid of the fraction and change the coefficient of x from negative to positive. Make sure that when you are multiplying both sides of the equation by a number, that you do it on both sides times all the terms. Notice that I did 1/2 times 2 to give me 1 for in front of the x. Notice I did 2 times 5/2 in order to get 5, and then I did 2 times 6 to get 12. And then I went and also did the negative at the same time so that I ended up getting the positive 1x, the minus 5y, and the negative 12. So this equation is in standard form. X and y are on the same side. There are no fractions or decimals. X's coefficient is positive. In this case, it's a positive 1. And there, the GCF between the three numbers is 1. So we have A is 1, B equals 5, and C equals negative 12. So now we're going to look at our application problem. Particularly, we're going to focus at the speed of sound through water as it goes down, hits some fish, and then bounces back up to your sensor on your boat. So the speed of sound in water is 4,760 feet per second. So the question says, write a function that models the relationship between the number of seconds it takes for the sound signal to return to the boat. So let's first define some variables and identify what we know. So we know the rate. We know that the rate is 4,760 feet per second. Now, remember from Algebra 1 that we can use the rate to help determine what the x and y variables are r. We'll talk more about slope later on, but remember that slope is basically a rate. And when we're talking about slope, we're talking about the change in the y over the change in the x, the delta y over the delta x variable. And so when I look at my units on my rate, I have feet per second. So we know that if this is my rate and my slope and my equation, then my y variable has to be feet and my x variable has to be time. So my y value is going to be the feet, or the distance in this case, and my x variable is going to be the time in seconds. So the next thing we want to do is think about this problem. So I have my boat, and it's shooting a signal down into the water, and then it's bouncing off some fish. And then it's returning. So the distance traveled from the boat to the fish, that's what we want to know. So that's my y. But since it would be equal distance, relatively speaking, from the fish back to the boat, that is also y. So if you notice at this problem, it says they want to know how much time it takes for the sound signal to return to the boat. So that means it has to travel that whole trip. It has to travel from the boat to the fish, and then from the fish back to the boat. So normally with distance formulas, we have distance equals rate times time. And so in this formula, my distance isn't y, my distance is 2y, since it has to travel back from the fish and then all the way back to the boat. Makes sense to make a round trip. So I'm going to define my variable a little bit differently and say that y is the distance from the boat to the fish, just to clarify a little bit more what I'm finding. And then my rate, I know that already, is 4,760. And my time, I don't know. That's x. How long does it take to make that whole trip? And so if I want to solve this for y, then I'm going to divide both sides by 2. And so I get y equals 2,380 times x. So this equation models this situation. So the last part of this is to apply it. So suppose that the signal returned to the boat after 0.5 seconds. Estimate the depth of the school of fish. So we knew from the last part that our function is y equals 2,380 times x, where y represents the distance from the boat to the fish, and x represents how much time the sound waves have traveled through the water. So I can go ahead and substitute in 0.05 seconds into my variable spot. I can go ahead and do the multiplication. And when I do that, I get 119, and that's supposed to represent a distance. And so I know that the school of fish is 119 feet from the boat. This concludes the lesson. You are now ready to begin the homework.